I'll welcome everyone to our teach-in session on intersectional activism and advocacy, fighting the good fights. I am Dara Strolovitch, and I teach here in gender and sexuality studies, politics, African American studies, and American studies. And I want to thank everyone for coming. At some point, I thought it would be nice to go around the room and have everyone introduce themselves, but that would take 50 minutes. So I think we won't do that, but I will ask the student co-facilitators who are here today to just say a bit about the work, who they are and the work they do on campus, and then we'll talk for a few minutes before.
Okay, so I'm Jessica Quinter. I'm a junior in the Woodrow Wilson School, and I'm founder and president of Princeton Students for Reproductive Justice, so I'm here kind of in that capacity.
I should say, where can you on or off campus, because people always think of both.
I'm Alex Leslie. I'm a sophomore and I'm a
chair here. Hi, I'm Marie Locano. I'm a senior. I'm a chair here on campus and off campus. I've been involved in organizations that provide legal service for victims of domestic violence.
Hi, I'm Colleen. I'm a senior in the politics department. I'm also a chair here, and I've also worked with organizations on issues around domestic violence.
Hi, my name is Julie. I am a senior in the philosophy department, and I was a former president of Students for Prison Education and Reform, and I'm still involved.
Thanks. So, as everyone knows by now, it's a very short session. There's a lot to try to squeeze in. I was saying to students earlier that I've done workshops on this topic that take a whole day or a whole weekend, a semester-long course on intersectional activism now, and even with what I'm sure those of you who are in or have taken the class would agree is way too much reading. We still don't manage to cover everything, even in the 12, don't smile that much. We still don't manage to cover even a fraction of what we could or should or would like to, but our hope is in this brief time together we can take some of the insights of ideas and research about intersectionality and make them local and actionable by using them as a lens onto the kinds of work that many of you do at Princeton and beyond, and as well, and also on the challenges of the moment. So I'm going to start by talking very briefly about what intersectionality means. I guess that doubles as the whiteboard. I was not going to write on it, but I guess we'll just talk. I won't write. Tell you a little bit about what I've found in some of my research, and then mostly have a discussion with the panelists, and I hope many of you as well, about what I characterize as potential for, strategies for, and the challenges to intersectional activism, advocacy, and organizing, things that you've experienced, and then try to end by bringing some of those into conversation with some of the insights from what research and writing by scholars and activists suggests might be some strategies. So just kind of a few people, when you hear the word intersectionality, what do you think of? Anyone? What did you think of before Friday, Thursday? Oh, sorry, hi.
I think of actively including and censoring voices in across gender lines, racial lines, able lines, religious lines, as many lines as possible.
Yeah, that's an important, very important component. Just one or two more to throw out there. Everyone's behind me. Sorry.
When I think of intersectionality, I think of Professor Kimberly Crenshaw, who coined the term, talking about, from my understanding, the ways in which multiple areas of identity or marginalization can create new specific forms of marginalization and oppression.
Yeah, so multiplicity and compoundedness are important. Anyone else? I want to put it on. Oh, yeah, here.
I visualize the Venn diagram.
Yeah.
Circles are related together. Yeah. Each other has a different thing to add.
Yeah, the number of books about intersectionality, that Venn diagram on the cover, is plentiful. And as Tara Hunter reminded us in her introduction to Kimberly Crenshaw's talk last Thursday, although Kim Crenshaw coined the term, the concept has existed for a much longer time, particularly but not only in Black feminism. And one way of thinking about it as an intervention is into what the late sociologist Chen has characterized as the repeated painful failure of social movements can come to terms with multiple simultaneous nations. And so just sort of to take as a working definition and a sort of slanted definition, as we talk today, sort of working but provisional and admittedly incomplete, definition would be this set of ideas that are kind of an expanded version of what was in the blurb for this session. So the idea is that at its core, intersectionality is the idea that groups can be marginalized along many axes of the system of domination within which Patricia Collins has called the matrix of domination, that these systems of oppression and multiple forms of marginalization, things like racism, white supremacy, capitalism, ableism, misogyny, homophobia, and heteropatriarchy, don't function as separate, fixed, or parallel tracks, but are instead interconnected, dynamic, simultaneously compounded, and mutually constitutive. Intersectional approaches also typically object to or forcibly reject kind of either-or approaches that try to sort of pit economic and social justice issues as against each other or mutually exclusive, or the implication, as Rinku Sen, who's the executive director of Race Forward, has put it, that, for example, and you could sort of substitute any of these terms, class war is universal, but race, gender, sexual liberation are particular and not appealing to all of humanity. So it attempts to sort of say that something is more foundational or fundamental or universal, and these other axes are sort of particular, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And then as a kind of way of thinking, they urge us to ask, do what Mara Matsuda, legal scholar, calls asking the other questions. When we see something that looks racist, she writes, we should also ask, where is the patriarchy in this? When we see something that looks sexist, we should look for the heterosexism in it, et cetera. It's also, come to be a bit of a blanket term for a whole range of phenomena. So not only intersections among issues, but also a descriptor for problems, a diagnosis of problems, a set of way of thinking about solutions to problems, and basically sort of a way of thinking. And so in some of my research, I've tried to understand some of the processes through which intersectional marginalization actually happens, there's a Venn diagram, happens in politics and policy, even among well-intentioned progressive political actors, by examining the extent to which and the ways in which organizations that have as their mission to try to represent or advocate on behalf of marginalized groups, how they attend to issues constituted by the intersection of multiple forms of marginalization. And I'm not going to go into very much detail, but just to kind of put some of the main punchlines out there so that we have them as a common basis for conversation. Oh, and these are some of the ways I thought about those issues. Among the key punchlines, and sorry, this is the important one, is that, and these are predicted probabilities showing us the likely level of work on issues, and just to be clear here, the disadvantaged subgroup issue, the white bars, is what I'm thinking of as the intersectionally constituted issues. Can see that even after controlling for a range of all kinds of political and other factors, the organizations that I study were significantly more active on issues affecting their advantaged constituents and really at the expense of issues affecting intersectionally marginalized constituents. So for example, just to kind of pull out a few, among both women's and feminist organizations and African American groups, and this was in the 1990s, they were all far more active on affirmative action in higher education, so an issue that is an important one but affects a relatively advantaged subgroup of women and of people of color, than they were when it came to welfare reform, which has major implications for intersectionally marginalized groups of women and low-income people of color. And then the thing in yellow is highlighted because kind of stave off the question I usually get, which is, well, isn't this just about identity, sort of trumping economics? When I ask economic justice organizations about how active they were when it came to public funding for reproductive health, services, that was the lowest scoring issue. So they were least active out of all the organizations I looked at. And just pulled out a couple of quotes from some of the interviews that I did for the study. They're suggestive of, there are many processes going on, but at least a few of the things that I think lead to those results, those patterns, is that activists and advocates systematically overestimate and universalize the impact of issues that affect more privileged subgroups of their constituencies while systematically underestimating and particularizing those that affect intersectionally marginalized subgroups. There's also this feeling this sort of sentiment that there's someone else's issues. So this last quote from the Economic Justice Organization, when I asked them about their work on public funding for reproductive health services and the Hyde Amendment, they characterized this as, we don't do work on other people's stuff. Our work has been on economic questions. The only way to defend cultural liberalism is with a strong populist economics that persuades white men to vote their pocketbook. This was in the mid-90s, so nothing new under the sun, basically. And you can see some similar patterns in these other organizations as well. But this was all work based in the 1990s, and this, for those of you who can remember that far back, is sort of commonly thought of as a relatively calm and compared to the 2000s, okay time. And so if these organizations were this uneven in their allocation of resources and advocacy during what are normally thought of as good times, I wondered what was going to happen after 9/11 and under a Bush administration when times were ostensibly bad. So one way of thinking about this is, how can we think about the effects of hard times for groups and issues for whom times are always, in some ways, hard? And I think this part of the question is particularly relevant again now. So I did a follow-up study with a second survey in 2007, and there I examined what happens to intersectional advocacy during these hard times. And those were the questions that I asked. I did a survey, I'll go back to that for one sec. I did a survey of advocacy groups, included a series of questions in which I asked them to list up to 5 policy issues that had been important to them in 2000, and then basically asked them how much harder or easier they'd become after that. And these, again, are the sort of depiction of the likelihood that they said something had gotten more difficult, easier, or whether there had been no change. And the key is this big, tallest black bar on the sort of middle right, which shows that the chances that an issue affecting intersectionally marginalized groups had gotten harder was the most likely outcome in the whole study. And this, too, was controlling for a whole range of possibilities. So in other words, it's important that we understand that the hard times, like the ones we're in, are hard for everybody, but also that they exacerbate the same kinds of patterns that are present even in good times, and we'll talk more about this later, that we sort of remain cognizant of that as we sort of engage in the kind of crisis politics of the moment. So I think that was about 10 minutes. Yeah, okay. So with that by way as background now, I want to turn to the panelists and also to people in the room. I know there are a lot of people, so we may not get to everybody, but I think probably a lot of people in here, even people who I can't see behind me, have something to contribute here. And I want to spend most of the rest of the time on a conversation about the promises of and the challenges to and then the possibilities for intersectional activism. And again, as gleaned from your experiences working on issues on campus and off campus. And then I'm hoping we can also talk a little bit about what new challenges, possibilities, stakes, etc. might be presenting themselves to us in the last several months. So if you guys are set, the questions I'm going to ask them to answer, and then people can join us, I hope, are to talk about an organization or issue they've been involved in either on or off campus, in which they tried to make some kind of what we might think of as an intersectional intervention, to say a little bit about what felt important and promising about doing so, what their hopes were for these kinds of interventions, a little bit about the barriers or stumbling blocks, what they learned from them, whether they see any hurdles or new stakes in the election. And then I'd like to end the conversation by focusing on some of the lessons that you've learned that other people might have learned as well, and to think about what we can do to incorporate a more intersectional lens into the way we do our politics, tie that back to some of the research that I and others have done. So think about what seems promising, what seems like ways through. So with that, perhaps we'll start with Julie, is that okay?
Sure. So I am involved in Students for Prison Education and Reform, which is a criminal justice advocacy group on campus. I guess what comes to mind about a couple of ways that we've tried to approach the topic of prison reform from an intersectional perspective, I guess I can bring up maybe like three discussions or campaigns that we pulled off. So first, last year we started a campaign asking Princeton to divest from private prisons. And we formed a coalition of a number of student groups. So we reached out to the Dream Team, the immigrant activist group on campus, the Black Justice League, a couple of other groups, and I think I can speak a bit about that experience working together, how that worked well, I think, in our favor, and also the barriers that we had to overcome in really working with that. So I think, I guess divestment, so it's still a campaign that's going on, and it really occurs at the level of, or most of it has occurred at the level of speaking with administrators and working with administrators, which I think is a fairly frustrating process, to be honest. like, just to be completely fair, and I think that has often posed a barrier for us being able to act intersectionally. One, because I guess meeting an administrator, you can't really have that many people in the room. Two, I guess SPEAR is a predominantly white organization, which is something that we've been trying to address and have done so with varying levels of success. And I think that the fact that we are a predominantly white organization has sort of enabled us to have easier contacts with administrations than a lot of, I guess, more diverse groups on campus would have, I guess for a variety of reasons. And I think that sort of, those connections with administrators have been productive for our work, but have maybe made us less able, or have at least posed a barrier to including other groups. But I think so I guess that was a barrier. Thinking about successes, though, or at least how intersectionality has added to that campaign, I think incorporating the voices of Dream Team was really productive to our campaign, particularly since a lot of the privatization that occurs in carceral facilities occurs at the detention stage with immigrant detainees. So I think having them as a source of knowledge in our campaign was really helpful. I think we could have done a better job of bringing them as equal partners in the issue, sort of because I guess the way that a lot of student group organizing works and the way that Otis, which is the like student group facilitator on campus, works is that a lot of activities on campus have to be sponsored by student groups. So it was really hard to build a coalition that seemed like everyone was being given equal recognition and also equal responsibility while still having to go through official channels. I don't want to talk too much, so I don't know if I should. Yeah, I think I'll just pass it over to the next student, actually, but that's the investment in SPEAR.
Great, thank you. That structural stuff at the end seems important. Colleen, you were going to say some stuff about campus, but also working at a national organization, too.
Yeah, sure. Since I know we have like several share peers here, I can talk a little bit less about share and maybe more about an experience I had this summer. So I had the opportunity to intern at the National Network to End Domestic Violence, which is a DC-based advocacy organization. And I remember going into this internship right after taking Professor Strolovitch's intersectional activism class. I was a little bit, I guess, nervous because I wasn't really sure how they addressed the issue of domestic violence, because this was an organization that was created on the heels of the Violence Against Women Act, which has had, I think, different effects on different communities, right? Because it really does take a very, you know, punitive perspective on addressing domestic violence and things like, you know, mandatory arrest laws and things like that, and how that adds to mass incarceration and how that affects, you know, predominantly like people of color and poor communities. So I was a little nervous going in, but as I got there and, you know, even just as I was introduced to the organization's culture, I was really pleasantly surprised to how they looked at the issue of domestic violence, because the way they said it, they were like, we're not going to end domestic violence if we only talk about domestic violence. We're only going to be able to end violence if we talk about racism, if we talk about sexism, if we talk about homophobia, if we talk about classism. So the projects I was working on this summer were largely issues of economic justice that I really wasn't expecting to be working on. So a lot of the meetings I went to were strategy meetings on the Hill around the Earned Income Tax Credit, which is really important for low-income workers, and expanding the Earned Income Tax Credit to people without children. And especially because, you know, domestic violence, we're always kind of told that, oh, this is something that happens to, like, women and women with children particularly. The idea that a domestic violence organization was working on this specific issue was really surprising to me in a good way. So I think what I learned this summer was the importance of kind of addressing these issues that in some lights only seem tangentially related to things like, you know, violence against women that is a majority group issue. And I think really focusing on these specific issues that affect, you know, the most marginalized people who are affected by violence is really helpful. But at the same time, I think, you know, looking back at a lot of these strategy meetings were with Democrats who expected to win the Senate and expected to have someone who was really, you know, really invested in this issue. The fact that, you know, the Obama administration is probably the historically friendliest organization to addressing violence against women. You know, we had the White House advisor on violence against women. Joe Biden has, you know, the It's On Us campaign. So I'm not really sure what their advocacy is going to look like in kind of these, you know, harder times under the new administration, but I think the idea of focusing on these, like, smaller specific issues around, say, you know, economic justice or racial justice or gender justice that aren't specific to interpersonal violence seems like a really productive way forward. So I'll talk a little bit about some things that Cher has been doing this year. In particular, I want to talk about a really great conversation we had with SPEER at the beginning of this year, which is the Students for Prison Education and Reform Group. And sort of, I think some of the goals of that conversation were to like think about and talk about how sort of the narratives of sexual violence sort of were used and interacted in sort of carceral systems. I think that was very, very valuable for SPEER, and for me in particular, in my thinking about the issue. In particular, I remember in that conversation, I sort of brought up a statistic about repeat offenders of sexual assault, and somebody from SPEER sort of challenged that statistic and sort of called on me not to sort of essentialize perpetrators. And I think that was really valuable for my and for Cher's sort of narrative and the ways we sort of thought and thought more broadly about, you know, the people involved in this problem and sort of the work that we were doing. So I really hope that continues. And I think in terms of the lessons on intersectional organizing on this campus specifically, I think with groups like SHARE and a lot of student groups that sort of are in an educational role, are trying to reach students who sort of are less informed than we are ourselves, it's sort of hard to recognize the limits of our own knowledge, but I think that's something that's really important to do when we're trying to be intersectional as well.
Sorry. So I think something else that Shara did this fall and that we've done for a couple of years was a study break for Domestic Violence Awareness Month. And we partnered with a number of organizations across campus to talk about the ways that domestic violence affects different communities on our campus. So we partnered with the Asian American Students Association, with the Muslim Students Association, Black Student Union, and a pretty wide range of organizations. People were really excited about being involved. And I think what was important to us about that was, as an organization, both in terms of like trying to educate the entire campus community, but also in terms of trying to educate ourselves on like how we can best be supporting students on campus, it was really important for us to hear what specific challenges might be for specific groups on campus. I think one of the challenges that we've faced, that we actually talked about a little bit this morning, was this idea that there are these established groups on campus that I think get called on a lot to be the spokespeople for these different issues. And to a certain extent, like, it's not necessarily fair to ask people to show up every single time. And I think some of the people we talked to were sort of concerned about speaking about domestic violence within the communities because it honestly just wasn't something that people necessarily thought that they had a lot of knowledge about. So I think one of the challenges we faced was like figuring out how to balance wanting to have those voices in the conversation with like pressuring specific individuals who didn't necessarily, shouldn't necessarily have been pressured.
Jessica.
So as I said, I'm founder and president of Students for Reproductive Justice, and I would say in terms of an intervention I can speak to was really more an effort to bake in intersectionality into the group kind of from its inception, since we were just formed at the beginning of last semester, so very new. But it was a very intentional focus in terms of, like, the impetus for wanting to start this group was not just the fact that there was a kind of anti-choice voice on campus and not a response from the other side, but also that that kind of narrowed the focus of the issues that were being discussed, which kind of speaks to a particularly fraught history of reproductive rights in general in terms of it being kind of led by the voices of white middle-class women and focusing exclusively on issues of abortion and choice as opposed to larger issues of access. So making it reproductive justice was a very intentional choice in trying to make sure that it was intersectional from the start. And it was also kind of supported by my work over the summer at the Center for American Progress on the Women's Initiative team, where I did a lot of work on how reproductive justice is economic justice and how those are kind of inextricably intertwined. So that was the goal going into the group. And I think it's had so far mixed outcomes. So one thing that we spoke about this morning in kind of our smaller meeting is the way in which student groups form on this campus, and I think probably to an extent broadly in the world, is that it tends to start from already established social networks. And so if I'm starting a group, or anyone will tend to reach out to their friends to get it started. So it can that kind of tendency seems to counteract the need for intersectionality in its inception. So I think that that's one barrier that we've experienced is, as we're getting started, making sure that we're not just relying on people who are the same as us because they're the most accessible to us. I also think that in the kind of aftermath of the election, one thing in particular that kind of a bunch of us spoke to is not wanting to alienate other students in particular. And so I think that that also speaks to a tension with an intersectionality in terms of not wanting to alienate other groups, but also not wanting to neutralize or water down your message so much so that it's no longer activism focused. So for example, some of the more, well, some of the only events we've had thus far were ones focused on menstruation and contraception. And I think part of the reason those were so successful is because there's a way in which we were trying to present the information as if, like, this is just the way it is, so it's no longer politicized, but if you, which I think can be really valuable in terms of bringing into people and just fomenting an environment in which activism could grow from people who are not already plugged into the network, but can also be difficult if you're trying to make change to distill it down too far. Those have been kind of hard to process.
Thanks. Well, I want to make sure other people have a chance to talk, and about just over halfway through our time. But before I open it up, I just want to, I know that you've all now sort of said your initial thing, and whether you want to respond to or anything sort of was jogged by listening to others.
I think just to build on what you were saying about, like, not wanting to like isolate people, I think that that's something that Cher talks about a lot, particularly because our main role really is supporting students. And so it's very, very important for us that, like, all students on this campus feel that if they experience anything, they can come and talk to a Cher peer, come to talk to the Cher office. And so one of the ongoing conversations we've been having is about kind of how to respond to this election and different things that come out of this election. And I think where we've fallen is sort of in that realm of neutralizing. And I think it's a hard place to be because many, many, many of the things that this administration has done have an effect on survivors of domestic violence or sexual assault or sexual harassment or stalking. In a way that's not necessarily immediately obvious, like what Colleen was talking about the income tax credit, things like that. And I think we've sort of talked about just talking about things that have a very direct impact, so changes to Title IX, for example, because that's something that we feel like doesn't isolate people. But it also closes us off from having a more intersectional conversation. So I think that that's been another ongoing challenge for us.
I would just add that one thing that occurs to me in terms of intersectionality as well is trying to find the balance between finding a larger issue that more groups can kind of unite underneath without kind of giving away too much of your own value. So I think one of the main problems of intersectionality is trying to show to people why it should matter to them what you're trying to do. So, for example, in terms of reproductive justice issues, another reason it seemed important to me at this time was, from my anecdotal experience, it seemed like the whole women's health case, for example, got a fair amount of media attention, but certainly less.
Explain what that is.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So Whole Women's Health versus Hellerstedt was a case that the decision came out in June, and it was regarding several trap laws targeting regulation of abortion providers in Texas, and whether or not they were constitutional, and whether they were an undue burden on a woman's right to access abortion. So in that case, they found in favor of the clinic and said that both the requirements in place did constitute an undue burden. But I think that in some sense, that certainly did not get the media attention that, for example, Roe v. Wade is so well known. And even less attention has been given to cases regarding things like the Hyde Amendment, which specifically is for women on, it regulates women on Medicaid and in terms of public funding. So it's a very specific segment of the population. And I think it's tough to try to show to people who aren't within that population why it's important to them to fight for it. So in like my academic work, in terms of policy proposals, I've tried to show like reproductive justice policies are important at reducing poverty for low-income women of color. But more than that, like, if you don't think reducing poverty is a legitimate aim of government, then it also makes tax sense because you spend less money on public funding for abortions than you would down the road of having them attended. So, but that's a really difficult balance, I think, to find is I don't really want to make the tax or public funding kind of argument. So how much do you give in to kind of the larger issue and how much do you hold on to your values but risk not bringing as many people?
Yeah, the questions of coalition that brings up are important ones as well. We can talk about it. Anyone else want to add anything? Okay. I guess I would like to open it up. I know there are lots of people in the room who are involved in a lot of issues on campus, and so either sort of additional to go back to my prompts there. Sort of experiences you've had either off campus that speak to some of these issues, present, you know, things that have felt promising but also challenging, and maybe even strategies you've used or have found more or less successful in trying to do work that we might think of as intersectional politically. Yeah, all right. I just didn't know that I should turn around.
So I'm a scientist. I'm a physics PhD student. And the point you brought up
maybe
about...
Maybe say your name.
Sid. I'm Sid. The point you brought up about issues relevant to disadvantaged groups becoming exacerbated when down to heart resonated with me a little bit because, yes, a lot of scientists are starting to become more engaged after the election. And I guess when a big majority of people go out into the forefront, some of the issues they look at might not be with a very nuanced point of view. There's this March for Science that some of you might know in about a month and a half. And I sometimes feel disengaged from this community because some of the issues, not only ones relevant to scientists, are looked upon in a sort of not nuanced way, in the way we've been talking about it. So I guess my question is, I feel like I should belong in this community, but I don't because they don't take these things into account. So scientists are getting involved, but not only with respect to issues relevant to science, but also women's issues or more generally. But because it is, I guess, a male dominant field, and the demographic is very specific, it is. People are thinking about things who haven't really thought about things in a very way before. I guess it's a general point of view.
Yeah, so thinking about, sort of, as you suggested, going back to this question about politics in hard times and the ways in which it sort of might create what feel like crises to people who did not see problems before. Is that one way of thinking?
Right,
of
but the way they see problems now can be very different from the way they'd be seen with a more nuanced eye, for example.
Yeah, and I think you're sort of putting this out there as both a problem and a question.
Yeah,
and I don't want to sort of position myself here as the person who's now going to like look at you and answer. So if people have, and perhaps the panelists have some ideas, but I think it's also, you know, it's a very general question about sort of political engagement and how to think about what it means to kind of bring new people in, right? And I think one of the things that's been interesting energizing to me in the last few months, in the kind of silver lining sense, has been that in some ways this discourse of intersectionality has become part of the political discourse, and so there's actually sort of a language and a set of tools that it gives us for speaking to people about, you know, how they might think in more, you know, I wouldn't say you need to be more nuanced to someone you're trying to.
Yeah, that sounds condescending. But I guess the question is how to go about that in a nuanced way.
Yeah. And I'll talk a little bit about some ideas and strategies, but I think, I guess one thing I would say is that I think the language of intersectionality, right, itself is part of that way. So to have conversations with people that in which you sort of sensitize them to the ways in which the kinds of issues that they are now concerned about historically are related to issues they might not be thinking about as much. And, you know, this is not the best example, but just one example might be all of this concern about public funding for science being under assault. And again, I admit this is not the most intersectional example, but it's an example. You know, funding for the humanities is under assault every Tuesday,
yeah.
Right? And so even sort of just thinking about that as a way into a conversation about the ways in which issues that now feel salient to a new group of people are connected to other issues that are, you know, or in speaking to people at Princeton about cutting money for anything, to sort of enter into a conversation about the fact that every Wednesday, mm-hmm. funding for public higher education and community mm-hmm. colleges is on the chopping block, or our colleagues at universities' tenure is under assault. I mean, again, perhaps not the most intersectional in the sense of, you know, thinking about issues that we've been talking about, but in terms of, you know,
the humanities are like the other people's stuff.
And possibly not just other people's stuff, but for some people, other people's kind of dumb stuff, right? Like, trivial stuff that they may not support, think the thing really actually deserves funding either, mm-hmm. right? That kind of thing. I hope that sort of gets at some of what you, yeah. Okay, Tanika.
I'm a PhD student in the politics department. I think this is a really interesting discussion, and one thing that maybe has been sort of skirted around but not spoken about explicitly yet is the idea of making sure there's like descriptive representation of disadvantaged subgroups within organizations. So I think there's been a lot of discussion of the difficulty in including people who have totally different experiences. So for example, maybe like a women's group might have trouble connecting with like male minority students, but if there are, you know, women of color on that particular committee or group, they can probably build these types of bridges. And I think a good step towards inclusivity is having that descriptive representation within the leadership.
Yeah, that's a definite important piece of the conversation, and I think I would sort of layer onto descriptive representation, and I think this has sort of been percolating under the surface, attempts at sort of at non-tokenizing mm-hmm. and sort of effective sort of tipping point descriptive representation. But as I'll say in a few minutes too, I think, and as Professor Kentra said the other night, I think we want to kind of balance recognizing the limitations when groups are not sufficiently diverse, at the same time as we want to understand the issues as the issues themselves, right? And thinking about politics and not just
bodies in particular places. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a Princeton resident and I'm a citizen. I've got my sons in the school system. So I work in New York, but today I took a day off to attend these mm-hmm. sessions. And the reason I got involved was that I'm an immigrant. I'm a U.S. citizen, but I immigrated to this country, and I'm from a Muslim background. And I started hearing things coming from Washington that, like, the Muslims are bad, the Spanish are bad, the blacks are bad. So, well, this worries me.
Yeah.
And the America that I knew, and the reason I immigrated to America was the American values. So this looks to me like against American values. But I've got some very nice friends who are my neighbors who are Republican. And I discussed with them, and they totally agree with this. So
with
the current
administration,
they are like, they say this is our person, and he represents us, and he's the voice of the people. So I said, okay, mm-hmm. so if this is the voice of the people, but I'm a little worried, because I heard this kind of voice in Germany, like 60, 70 years ago. So I hope this doesn't country doesn't go to that. So that's why I'm a little involved now, because I don't want America to become Germany.
Amen.
Yeah,
and I think in some ways this sort of speaks back to the question of the sort of invigorating, for better or worse, moment we're in, as well as kind of connection among contemporary issues to historical ones, and the difficulties that some of the panelists have talked about in terms of trying to talk to people or to sort of do one's politics in a way that leave open the possibilities of conversation with people with whom you might disagree in very at the moment when the stakes are very high.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
So does the panel have any suggestion of like how to make America like one again?
You mentioned you came to this country with the promise of American values. Can you talk about more specifically, like the values that you felt that America represented?
Well, America still has those values. So, like, every person should be counted on his own, and you should be responsible for your own personal actions. So, for example, if something bad happens anywhere in the world, why do I have to answer to that person? And like, why does every Muslim have to answer for something bad done by someone else? Or some Spanish, someone has to answer. Everyone should be accountable for himself. If someone does a crime, or if a group of people does crime, they should be, of course, held accountable for.
Mm-hmm.
But everyone should be judged for his own actions.
Yeah.
So, but this group thinking of classifying people in a very simple way, like what was done 70 years ago, that is not, that can't be, it's a dangerous thing.
Just to tie back into intersectionality, I think it's really important that this is an opportunity for all of these marginalized groups to get together and work together, because it's the same divide and conquer that the United States and other countries has experienced throughout history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Other questions, comments?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I would just add that I think part of the difficulties we're seeing right now in terms of this moment is trying to find how we can coalesce with other groups, or how kind of issue-specific groups can work together and still have a concrete achievement or aim. So that's kind of some of the controversy we saw over the Women's March, for example. What was the point if you're subsuming so many smaller groups into it? And I think that's a really tough tension that we're seeing. And more than just that, it's a question of whether you take turns kind of with issues. So, for example, doesn't matter what issue is particularly salient at that moment. So if we're all gonna, if, you know, kind of women's groups are gonna get together with immigration rights groups and groups that work to reform the prison system, things like all those kinds of groups, is it, okay, now we're all gonna get behind like the executive order on immigration because that's the most important right now, and then later it'll be our turn, so to speak, or does it have to kind of dissolve and reform as something with larger values altogether? And I think that's something that kind of America is grappling with, and especially kind of activated America is grappling with at this moment in responding to Trump.
Yeah, in some ways sort of crystallized, you know, so America and beyond are grappling with those questions, and in some ways that's one of the, another way of characterizing that statement from Sharon Kurtz earlier, that groups keep getting told to wait their turn, and a sort of question of intersectionality is sometimes just invisibilized, but sometimes wait your turn, and in some ways the question becomes when is my turn, when is our turn, and questions from concerns that once the kind of easy fruit has been, or the low-hanging fruit has been picked, that people, and I'll talk about this in a minute, sort of take their politics and go home. And I think that, to sort of go back to some questions from earlier, is sort of an overarching question and concern for people who have been involved in issues for a long time, that, there's this new upsurge in activity, and then maybe once the sort of desperation wears off, the newly activated will go home. And I think to sort of continue with the thought I started earlier, one of the, I think, important and exciting things about this moment is that I think in, at least in sort of political communities that I see and speak with when I speak, there's a real attempt to not succumb to that cynicism, to see this as a real moment for expanding and organizing and sort of invigorating politics rather than bringing an intersectional sensibility, but trying not to bring the cynicism at the same time. I promised I would get to, we have, I think, 3 minutes left. What's that?
Hi, I work in Forbes College, and I actually attended Kimberly Crenshaw's talk as well on Thursday. And I think another element of this conversation has to be that, we have to remember the history and not revise the history because of the current circumstance. I think the way we're viewing what's happening now is, as you mentioned, it's urgent for a lot of people for whom this is new. This is very new ideas around, suppression and oppression and, marginalization and exclusion. And so making sure that we're not hearkening back to sort of a history that we thought was, but now opening ourselves up to the fact that this has been going on for a very long time for lots of different people. How do we reconcile that with what we feel personally right now? Do you know what I mean? So it's just a great way for us to, say, like, okay, now we're in it together. We're really trying to tackle these issues that have been, sort of affecting certain populations more, impactfully than others for a very long time. It's not about comparing, the oppressions, but it's about acknowledging the history that comes with what we see today.
Yeah, I think one sort of word, sorry, I can't see you.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, okay, I'm just sort of talking at the pole. Is sort of de-exceptionalizing
exactly.
The moment by thinking about both a longer arc and also, I think, interconnectedness, and we have 2 minutes, so I want to make sure, see if we have any last comments, and then I promised people can read that. It's not just put together slide. I promised some lessons, but does anyone have any last thoughts before I go through some of these sort of more strategically oriented points?
Not even the balancing, but the reckoning with intersectional movements and leadership and support with privileged groups.
Mm-hmm.
For example, there's a lot of men in here, and in the Woodrow Wilson School, the grad student there, a lot of the grassroots organizing work that is being led by students are mostly led by women of color, and so there's not a lot of guys who are helping with these groups. And I fear that one of the reasons guys don't want to help with the groups is for one, either blind spots or because they're not sure about how to navigate the space of supporting women leaders and working on equal levels with them without co-opting or speaking louder or resorting to the things that men have been trained in and socialized to do and do actively. So same thing goes along racial lines of white versus other people of color. How do we reckon with that?
Yeah, thank you. I think those are important points that that we'll now get into in the last 30 seconds. I'm kidding. These marathons. One thing I should say is I started out saying this is a very short session. There's a lot to cover, more than we can ever cover, and it's we've covered a lot total, but in a very sort of tip of the iceberg sort of way. And one of the things that I'm hoping will come out of this conversation, in particular in the day, more generally, is that this will be the first of many such conversations. I know there are ongoing conversations on campus, but I hope to keep talking to you and others about these questions. So just very quickly, and again, this is going to be beyond cursory, some of the things gleaned from some of the work I and others have done, and these are things that people have mentioned, to be intentional about intersectionality, to bake it into your work, your mission, your mandate, to actually make it a metric by which you evaluate your efficacy and your success, to do the Matsuda ask the other questions when you're considering issues and courses of action. This goes to Tanika, promoting effective descriptive representation by using internal processes and practices. Processes gives me away this. I'm an immigrant here too from Canada. To improve the status of intersectionally disadvantaged groups within the organization. And I think, one sort of takeaway from a lot of works is descriptive representation isn't everything, but it's really not nothing either. There is something important there. This kind of brings together a lot of thoughts that people have expressed, which is the importance of maintaining a long-term view, a proactive agenda, and utopian vision of some kind. Nothing is ever over, no issue gets resolved, and you can't go home once you've gotten what you want. There were some interesting case studies after the Obergefell decision that overturned the Defense of Marriage Act that legalized same-sex marriage, with organizations having to that had been established only to pursue same-sex marriage. What were they going to do? And some of them actually kind of packed themselves up and said, okay, we're done, we're out of business. And other organizations kind of retooled and said, okay, we've been devoting all of our attention to this issue for the last decade. This is an opportunity to really sort of take seriously the critiques of the relatively exclusive focus on this relatively, I don't want to say narrow issue, but on this one issue, and have been, and in doing so at a kind of intersectional moment, many organizations have actually been doing some really great work, expanding their work to deal with issues of the rampant homelessness among LGBTQ youth, issues affecting trans people, et cetera. Similarly, everything seemed quixotic at some point. So this is the sort of proactive agenda. You can't just not pursue issues because they seem kind of high in the sky or out there. Whether it's the weekend or abolition or women's suffrage, all of these things seem like crazy ideas when someone first came up with them. Be willing to question questions and past practices and your frameworks and to evolve. I think this goes to questions to these, the importance of thinking about history or the point where we brought up about, sort of these oft-repeated things about, repeat offenders, et cetera, being not just willing but proactive in terms of questioning our frameworks and guiding assumptions. This is a more complicated one, but Dean Spade sometimes says that one way of evaluating a potential policy is this something we'll have to undo later? Is this some kind of issue where we're sort of pursuing a goal that is so at odds with what our actual ideological commitments are that at some point we know now we will be actively trying to undo it at some future point? Don't assume that other groups have some issue covered, but also don't assume that nobody's working on it. So probably so there's this kind of double edge that I find in my research, which is a lot of issues like public funding for reproductive health services, nobody was really working on in the 90s. There was this assumption among these economic justice organizations that this was a reproductive rights organization issue, and among reproductive rights organizations it wasn't quite as bad, but they too were assuming that this was more of a economic justice organization. But then there's also this sort of bravado that I think can happen when you're sort of like, okay, we're going to take this on and sort of steamroll over perhaps other organizations and people that are doing work. Don't universalize from the most privileged or particularize the narrow, to go back to those quotes from earlier, but do what bell hooks, Black feminist theorist and scholar, says, which is to theorize from the margins. Think not about trickling down, but trickling up. Or I was trying to think of a better word than trickle, like
flood of, or something like that, waterfall of, river, I don't know, something like that. Making effective use of coalitions and work with other organizations, cultivating intersectional linked data, I won't go into that. I think the one thing I'll end on, and I think this goes back to your point, is I think one of the, and this, I don't mean to sound too metaphysical, but I think one of the lessons of an intersectional approach is that we all need to sort of practice humility and patience, but also accountability when we do politics. Nobody, not even Kimberly Crenshaw, comes to politics as a perfectly intersectionally formed actor, right? We all have, I'm trying to think of words, we all have things that escape our notice, we all have positionalities, we all have biases that we bring to the table, and I think the important thing there is to be patient with ourselves and others as we navigate them, but also to feel accountable to ourselves and others and to hold other people accountable as well, but hopefully without a kind of culture of calling out and finger pointing, but rather kind of working toward an actual bigger tent. I'll just end there. Thank you all.